So welcome back to the next session. The next session would be on area moment and mass moment of inertia. So to start with, why it is inertia? See, that is one of the important concept, because we have looked at the Newton's second law also, where we said mass times acceleration. And there you see the inertia term is typically used for resistance. So that means the resistance to motion, that can be defined as inertia. Okay. So now if you look at statics and dynamics, there are two different aspects. In statics, we only talk about area moment of inertia, whereas in dynamics, we only talk about mass moment of inertia. So we are going to, talk about this, differently actually. So we'll first look at area moment of inertia, and then after that we are going to study mass moment of inertia. Remember that in engineering mechanics especially, you will not find the term I, that is area moment of inertia. You see that mostly on strength of materials types of courses, where for static problem we are actually solving for, let's say, deflection, bending, buckling, and so on and so forth. So you can clearly see that the resistance or inertia comes into play when the body is actually trying to deform in statics. So that's the whole issue about it, and that is why, in engineering mechanics it is not showing anywhere in any textbook. The second one, in rotational motion, when we consider, that is in dynamics, we also see the inertia. So there we also refer to I as the mass moment of inertia, but it is taken in a different aspect altogether, because their body is under already motion, therefore we should have the resistance in the form of mass moment of inertia. But in statics, the body is not at all motion, it is under static. So therefore, unless otherwise we get into the subject of deflection or bending or buckling, we are not going to really see the I terms, that is the area moment of inertia, coming into play. So with that, let's still try to look at what is area moment of inertia. How do I look at this? Remember, there is a well connection in centroid. Typically what we have done in centroid, I kept saying that we are taking a very elemental force, delta F, let's say, because if you think of a thin plate, once I am talking about a thin plate, I am interested in finding out of that thin plate where is the centroid. Okay. So in that one, really, if you think of in terms of a small weight of an area, right? So the force or the weight is proportional to the area. Now if it's a thin plate, that force is not varying with the distance. That's the whole issue. Okay. So in other words, that force is only proportional to delta A. However, remember there are problems where this force, that small force delta F, will vary with the distance from the axis. So we have seen this already in the hydrostatic pressure problem. However, we have not really thought about those problems in terms of moment of inertia. In case of a hydrostatic problem, what is happening? If you look at, let's say, A, B, C, D is the dam or valve, right, that we already studied. Then remember, we calculated a pressure. Pressure is equals to rho g y. Okay. Therefore, the force is equals to rho g y multiplied by dA. So therefore, you can clearly see that the force, right, on this elemental area is actually varying with the depth. So therefore, force is a function of y, distance from the axis AB. Okay. Therefore, if we really take the moment of this force, what we are getting is integral of y square dA. Okay. So, the moment about the axis AB in this case is y square dA. Similarly, when you look at the strength of materials in the bending of a beam, let us say a beam is bending and I am interested to find out the deflection, or just to let us look at how the stress is distributed. You will see that stress will be distributed in a linear fashion from an axis which we call the neutral axis. So, from this axis OO, we are going to see the stress, which is nothing more than, you know, kind of equivalent to the pressure. Again, it is varying in a linearly fashion. Therefore, what is happening? Again, you see that the moment produced by this force is going to be y square dA. So, moment is always proportional to y square, and that is why the resistance that the body sees, it is always in terms of the y square. Okay. Similarly, if you think of a torsion problem, let us say I have a torsion problem. So, what it means that I have a shaft and I am simply trying to give it a twist. Again, it can be shown that the stress distribution that we have, or that is going to vary linearly with respect to the radius. So, you have the stress as if in terms of kr, and if you take the moment of that, then it becomes kr square. So, everywhere you see that I have a resistance from the body in terms of y square. So, that resistance is a moment resistance given by the body in order to, you know, because it is trying to be under motion. Okay. So, it is either trying to deflect or buckle or twist. Therefore, it is given the resistance. So, with that basic concept now, what we see therefore, that in case of the centroid studies, I have only considered integral of y dA or integral of x dA. Okay. But in case of moment of inertia, we are really going to look at integral y square dA. Okay. So, the y square dA is nothing more than second moment of the area. So, in the centroid, as I kept telling you, that it is going to be only first moment of the area. The reason being, force is simply proportional to the dA. It is not varying from linearly from the axis of the concerned axis. Okay. So, therefore, we just concentrated on first moment. In this case, however, you see when we take the moment of y dA, it becomes y square dA. Therefore, we get the second moment of the area. Okay. So, in case of statics, moment of inertia can be simply said to be second moment of the area. So, we call it area moment of inertia or second moment of the area. So, ultimately therefore, what it boils down to, that if I want to define, let us say this is my shape. Okay. Now, in this shape, I want to find out the second moment of the area with respect to x axis, with respect to y axis. So, what does that mean? That means, again we are going back to the integration approach as we have adopted for the calculation of centroid. So, there if we take all of this into account, then we will see that I x is really equals to what? Y square dA, where dA is the small area dx dy, and Iy is equals to integral x square dA. So, therefore, the second moment of the area can be simply found by these two formulas. So, one is about the x axis, another is about the y axis. Again, problem is like this. Remember, if I take dA as dx multiplied by dy, we have to do a double integration, which is not easy. And we have said therefore, during the study of the centroid, typically we will always try to get into rectangular strip, right? Either it could be vertical, horizontal, or we will try to look at the problem in polar coordinates, clear? So therefore, now we are going to do the same thing here. Just understand this part correctly. So what we have in hand, I have again, let's say I am trying to solve this problem and I am interested in finding out what is the moment of inertia about the x axis. When I am interested to find out the moment of inertia about the x axis, then my chosen strip is actually horizontal. You see that? The strip that I have chosen is horizontal. Okay, this has an area how much? A minus x multiplied by dy. So if I want to calculate the moment of inertia of this small strip, then I just take the second moment of this, that means y square dA, where dA is clearly defined. Okay, now to get the Ix, all I had to do, I have to integrate it out, right, from 0 to some height. The problem is this, how about if I choose this element and try to calculate the Iy? If I choose this element, horizontal element, and try to calculate the Iy, it's going to be complex. Because first I have to know what is the moment of inertia of this element about its own centroid, okay? Or rather about an axis that is passing through its centroid and parallel to the y axis. So I have to first know what is the moment of inertia of this parallel to y axis that is passing through its own centroid. So therefore, to avoid this problem, what we do, if we want to calculate the Iy, we will prefer to choose a vertical strip. If I do choose a vertical strip, remember that now Iy is simply equals to x square dA, right, where dA is given by this area. Now this area is already defined, this is y multiplied by dx, okay. So we will go to, simply we will take x square dA and our problem can be easily solved by carrying out the integration along x, okay. So now let's look at a quick example therefore. Suppose I am interested in finding out the moment of inertia of this rectangle. So it's a rectangular area. I want to find out the moment of inertia about the x axis. So as I said, once I want to find out about the x axis, it will be always wise to get the strip horizontally, that is parallel to the x axis, so that the moment of inertia of this small element itself about its own axis, x axis, will be second order, which I can ignore. Okay, so only thing that we see is actually y square dA. Clear? So therefore, if I look at Ix, Ix is simply y square dA. So y square dA, now what is my dA? dA is nothing but b multiplied by dy. So b dy, if I substitute and if I carry out my integration from 0 to h, I am going to get b h cube by 3, which is a very well known result. So at least what we have now understood, okay, if I have a rectangular area, okay, so for the rectangular area, I know what is the second moment of the area, that means moment of inertia about the x axis, which is b h cube by 3. So what would be the moment of inertia then about y axis? The moment of inertia about the y axis will simply be equals to, just reverse this. Now there b becomes h, h becomes b, so it will be simply h b cube by 3. However, to get that, we will change the direction of the rectangular strip. We will just make it simply vertical strip, okay? So in some problems, you won't be able to avoid maybe this vertical and horizontal strip issues. So for example, now what is being demonstrated in this here, right here, suppose can I get the both Ix and Iy based on one strip concept? That means either I choose a vertical strip or either I choose a horizontal strip. Can I get both the moment of inertia? So what happens? Remember, when I choose the vertical strip, I should have no problem getting the moment of inertia about the y axis, because that is going to be simply x square dA, where dA is given by y dx, right? So for d, therefore, what is happening, the point here is dIy, the small moment of inertia that is developed about the y axis due to this rectangular strip, vertical strip, that is dIy, that is simply x square dA, that is x square y dx. Now you can easily integrate this out to get the Iy. However, if I want to get the Ix, what I have to know a priori, what is the second moment of area of this vertical strip, that small strip, about its own base, that is about the x axis. And we have already studied that. We have already said that of a rectangular area, it is always going to be bhq over 3. So therefore, when you are looking at the x axis, you can see the dIx of this rectangular area about its own base, right, that is equals to simply, now b becomes dx, so b is dx, hq is yq, that divide by 3. So we are really taking this one from our previous, you know, calculations. We are just taking bhq over 3, that is really dIx for this small elemental strip. Okay. So with this concept, now you can clearly see everything kind of boils down to the integration. So ultimately, all I had to do an x square dA or y square dA. So ultimately, the rectangular strip and vertical strip will again depend on the type of problem I have in hand for simple shapes. One more thing that comes into play when we have to calculate the moment of inertia about the z axis. Remember, here I have only talked about x and y axis. In this problem, everything in the x and y axis. So when we are trying to calculate the moment of inertia about the z axis, so z axis is perpendicular to the plane, that is typically called polar moment of inertia. So in polar moment of inertia, we will be calculating the moment of inertia of this body as if the body is trying to rotate about the z axis, right? So if the body is trying to rotate about the z axis, then I have basically Iz, which is referred to as J0 in this case. So that is the polar moment of inertia. And by definition, you can clearly see that if I have a little force, as I have explained the torsion problem, if I do have a force which is equals to kr, so force is varying linearly from the, let's say, the center, so therefore we have some kr here. So kr multiplied by r, that will create a moment which is kr square, right? So therefore we are basically having r square dA. Okay. Now what is r square? R square is nothing but x square plus y square. So therefore, what we have essentially for the polar moment of inertia, that is equals to x square plus y square dA. So if we break it, then x square dA plus y square dA, that is equals to Iy plus Ix. Okay. So polar moment of inertia is nothing but sum of the other two moment of inertia about x and y axis. But remember, in all of this problem we talked about, the body is trying to rotate about an axis. That's the whole idea. So when we are talking about Ix, when do I need Ix? When the body is trying to rotate about x axis. When do I need IY, body is trying to rotate about Y axis. And why do I need IZ, which is referred to as J0, polar moment of inertia, body is trying to rotate about Z axis. So, when the body gives this resistance to the motion, then we have to calculate this IX, IY for variety of problems such as bending, buckling, deflection and so on so forth, okay, in case of statics. So, for planar areas as we have discussed, now there is another important concept. The concept is as follows. If you now think of, suppose I have found the IX. Now, can I say like this? What I can say now that I will consider a very long strip which has the same area as that of A. So, which has the same area as that of A, and I am simply going to lump that area at some distance kx. So, there is a large rectangular strip which is parallel to the x axis, such that Ix of that strip about its own centroid can be ignored because I have a very large b and h is very, very small for that particular strip, okay. But at that area is equals to the original area. Then what we can say, then what is the moment of inertia of that strip which is having an area A, that is simply given by kx square multiplied by A. Okay. Then we will get a very important concept which we call the radius of gyration. See, what it is in physical term, it is basically the distribution of the shape. So, what it means, as if I look at, let us say, rectangular body, we can decide, okay, which way it is giving me the more resistance. Very quickly I can say, if I have the radius of gyration, which way it is giving me the more resistance. Okay. So, I can get the value of kx by simple this operation Ix by A, and I will be able to say wherever, you know, kx, if kx is more than ky, then I can simply say, okay, you know, now my body, you know, having more resistance about that axis. So, radius of gyration will be very fundamental, and you will see that only in static problem involving buckling. So, buckling means, let us say I have a column. So, in case of a buckling, let us say I have a column and I apply, you know, this vertical force. Now, depending on its shape, the column can buckle, try to buckle in any direction. Either it could be about x axis, either it could be about y axis. So, what we can look at, that which direction my kx, that means radius of gyration, is more. Is it along, you know, about the x axis or is it about the y axis? So, wherever it is more, it will not try to deflect on that direction, it will not try to buckle in that direction, but rather try to buckle in the direction where I have less radius of gyration. So, conceptually it will be very easy to thought out if we know the radius of gyration. Similarly, for the polar moment of inertia, okay, again it is a distribution of the shape all around the body. So, what is being done? Suppose you are taking an annular area of A. So, that area is equals to the actual area A. So, this is just an annular region. Then we can say what is the polar moment of inertia of this annular strip, that is simply given by k0 square A, r square dA. So, r square in this case is k0 square multiplied by A. So, I get k0 equals to square root of polar moment of inertia divided by A. Okay. So, therefore, I should be able to get also the radius of gyration about its z axis. Okay. So, let us try to study a few problems to find out the moment of inertia, that is second area moment in case of planar bodies. Okay, so we are not going to go to the three dimensional body, it is a 2D body as we have done in the case of centroids, we are going to do also for the moment of inertia. So let us say determine the moment of inertia of a triangle with respect to its base. Okay, so with respect to its base, if I study this, then as I said, it will be always preferred in this case to have the rectangular strip which is parallel to the x axis. So we do that, therefore, as we can see, the of this strip, what is the moment of inertia of this strip about the x axis, that is dix, is simply given by y square dA. Okay. Remember, the moment of inertia of this strip about its own centroid will be ignored, the reason being this dy is very small, because you are going to get a dy cube when you are trying to think of the moment of inertia about this own, about this rectangular strip, of this rectangular strip about its own centroid. So there will be a dy cube term that can be ignored. So only thing that is coming into play is y square dA. Okay. So therefore, now what is my dA? dA is L dy. Now L is actually varying with the height. Okay. So now you have to find L in terms of y. So we get L in terms of y in this case. All right. And then we substitute into the dA. And then dA will be substituted back to dix. So ultimately we are coming back to an integration process. In that integration process, we just have to integrate it from 0 to h. So I will get the moment of inertia about the x axis, which is bhq over 2l. So the moment of inertia of the triangle about its own base will be bhq over 2l. So now suppose I choose a vertical strip. So as I have commented here, could a vertical strip have been chosen for the calculation? What is the disadvantage to that choice? Now remember, in this problem, if I choose a vertical strip, although I can get the moment of inertia of this vertical strip itself about its base, that would be simply 1/3 dx y cube. But remember, there is a discontinuity in y as you touch this point. So in the integration limit, you have to break. You have to first go up to here, then again your integration limit on the dx should be from this height right here onwards. So that is going to create a major disadvantage to solve this problem if we start solving from the vertical strip concept. So now what we will do, first we will try to get the polar moment of inertia of a circular area by direct integration. So I am interested to get the polar moment of inertia of this circle by direct integration. And then from this result, I am trying to determine the moment of inertia with respect to its own diameter. That means moment of inertia with respect to, let us say, x, y. However, since it has axis symmetry, you can choose any diameter, it will be same. Moment of inertia all around will be same. So how do I attack this problem? How do I start solving this problem? Now you see I am changing the strip. So now I have an annular strip. Okay. So the annular strip was chosen at a radius u with thickness du. So ultimately what is varying is u, and therefore I have to integrate from 0 to r, where r is the radius of this circle. Okay. So therefore this is much easier because polar moment of inertia is already defined. So, if we look at it, polar moment of inertia of this annular strip, that is already u square dA, because it is coming from the concept of r square dA. Okay? Now, what is my dA? dA equals to simply the area of this annular strip, which is 2 pi u du. Therefore, the polar moment of inertia is equals to, can be just obtained by solving this integration. So, 0 to r, that is my integration limit, and therefore, I can solve it pi r to the power 4 by 2. Okay. Now, when the polar moment of inertia is solved, I already know that j 0 must be equals to I x plus I y. So, polar moment of inertia about the z axis, right, which is perpendicular to the slide, that should be equals to I x plus I y. We have already proved that. And now, in this problem, I x is equals to I y because it has bidirectional symmetry. It has symmetry in both directions. Not only that, even in this problem, you have symmetry all around. Okay. So, for this problem, we can clearly see that I x equals to I y, right, and therefore, we can simply say the either j 0 equals to 2 I x or 2 I y, and I should be able to get the either I x and I y. So, I diameter rather will be pi r to the power 4 by 4, okay, which is simply half of the polar moment of inertia. Okay, in other words, polar moment of inertia is twice that of the second moment of the area about any axis. Now, I have also commented why was an annular differential area was chosen. Would a rectangular area have worked? Of course, it would have worked, but problem would have been more complicated. We could have just chosen a rectangular strip also, no problem, but mathematically it would have been more difficult to solve it, that is all, okay, because then you had to have r square equals to x square plus y square, right. So, from that logic you had to either express x in terms of y or y in terms of x, but it would have worked, but mathematically we had to do more brainstorming. Okay. Now, remember, I can solve the same problem although the simplest possible way is what we have discussed in the previous slide. I could have solved it in this way also. Now, what I have done here, I have taken a very small elemental area. So, here the concept of dx dy is coming into play. Okay. So, ultimately, suppose I want to solve the I x, what is my I x? I x equals to y square dA. Now, remember dA has dx and dy, right. So, therefore, I would have performed also double integration. So, the problem is chosen because just to show the, show that, okay, we could have done also double integration to solve some problem. Okay. Now, when we do the double integration in this case, now how that is coming into play? Because since I have taken a small elemental area, remember that elemental area is taken at a distance r 0 from the center. Okay. So, therefore, this way it is d r 0 and here I have r d theta. So, r 0 d theta multiplied by d r 0 is my area. So, the area is coming into play here nicely. Okay. So, now remember since r 0 and theta both are varying, so I have to put the integration limit. So, the integration limit is taken from, for r it should be from 0 to r. For r 0 I have to take the integration limit 0 to r, and for theta I have taken the integration limit from 0 to 2 pi. Okay. Now remember, there is another important point here to consider: what is now my y square. Since I am calculating I x, I need the y square. So what is the distance of this from this x axis? It is simply given by r 0 sin theta. So that has to be substituted here. Okay. And once you do the full integration, I am going to get pi r to the power 4 by 4, okay, which is same as what I have got in the previous slide. I x is pi r to the power 4 by 4. So again, we can just leave it for the homework that can we find I y now. So I y equals to x square dA, right. So that can be easily done, because now you have to say what is x. X is nothing but r cosine theta, r 0 cosine theta. So you have to just substitute that, carry through this, and we are going to get the same result. So result is not going to change. Okay. Now let us look at determine the moment of inertia of the area under the parabola about the x axis. So we want to get the moment of inertia I x of this planar area, which is defined by x equals to k y square. Okay, so it is now x equals to k y square. Now remember, I could choose both strips in this case. One could be vertical and one could be horizontal. So we are going to explore in both ways. Let us first try to study. Okay, in order to get the Ix, I have always said that it is always advisable to go with a strip that is parallel to the x axis. So if I take a strip parallel to the x axis for Ix, then what I ultimately get? I ultimately have Ix equals to y square dA, right. So what is my dA now? Okay. So dA will be 4 minus x dy, right, as we can see here. So therefore, we know that dA in terms of y, okay, and therefore we should know what is Ix. Clear? So only thing again that is coming into play: what is the area of this small strip, and what is the second moment of this strip about the x axis? That means what is y square dA. Okay. So once we know that this is the simplest way to solve the Ix, now we can solve the Ix also. Can we solve the Ix based on a vertical strip? Okay. Now if you want to do that, remember, now I have to know what is the moment of inertia of this vertical strip itself about this base, that is the x axis. So that is nothing but dx y cube by 3, right, because the moment of inertia of a rectangular area about its own base is already learned, that is bhq over 3. So therefore, now you can see dix, as I said, is going to be dx yq divided by 3. All right. Now we simply have to integrate this now from 0 to 4 along the x axis. Remember, since my variable is x in this case, therefore y must be replaced in terms of x, which I can easily do, right? And that is what it is done. We have replaced y in terms of x, and therefore I can get the solution. So from both approaches, using horizontal strip or vertical strip, I am going to get the same answer. So what we'll do now quickly, one more important aspect that comes into play. Suppose I know about one axis, the moment of inertia, can I transfer to the other axis? So there we have to get the concept of parallel axis theorem. So for example, what is being asked here? Suppose I have a general area, I want to find out the moment of inertia of this rectangular area, this area, rather arbitrary area, about the axis AA prime. Okay. So, I know from definition that IAA prime, so IAA prime should be equals to y square dA, where y is the distance of that small area dA from the AA prime axis. Okay. Now, y can be broken into two parts. Y can be taken as d plus y prime. Now, what is d? This is very important. Now, d is the distance from the AA prime axis to the centroidal axis BB prime. Okay. So, if we do that, then we can see that I should be equals to integral y square dA, where y is equals to y prime plus d. Okay. Now, if you break it into just expand this one, then we have first term as y prime square dA plus 2d integral y prime dA plus d square dA. Now, what is coming back here? What is this term in the middle? What is my integral y prime dA? What does it mean? Remember, y prime dA, because this is a centroidal axis of this area, we have already learned. Y prime dA is nothing but the first moment, right? And the first moment of the area about its own centroidal axis should be equals to 0. Okay? So, what it boils down to ultimately, that this term is equals to 0. And therefore, what we have, I AA prime equals to I cap. So, I bar is given because now this integral y prime square dA, this is about the BB prime axis, which is a centroidal axis. So, ultimately we have I equals to I centroidal axis plus AD square. So, what it essentially means, that if I know the moment of inertia of simple shapes about its own centroid, then I can calculate using the parallel axis theorem about any axis which is parallel to that centroidal axis. Okay. So, therefore, we can take quick examples. For example, in this problem, let us say I am interested in finding out the moment of inertia of this circular area about this line, okay, about this axis. So, how do I do that? So, remember, we already know what is the moment of inertia about its own centroidal axis, this one, that is pi r to the power 4 by 4, right? And then all we had to do, we had to apply the parallel axis theorem. So, now I have a times d square, where a is pi r square and d is this distance. So, that is simply r square. So, I ultimately have the answer as pi r to the power 4 multiplied by 5 over 4. Okay. Similarly, let us look at the triangular area in different way. Now, what has been done? We have already studied in this problem what is the moment of inertia of this triangle about its own base AA prime. That is already known. About the base axis, we have already said it is going to be BHQ over 12. Now, can I get it about the centroid? Okay. So, can I get it about the centroidal axis BB prime? So, again we go to the parallel axis theorem. We know that IAA prime should always be equals to IBB prime, that is the centroidal axis, plus AD square, right? And therefore, we just change this. So, we are interested in now to find out what is IBB prime rather with respect to the centroidal axis. So, I just do IAA prime negative AD square. Now, this was already known. that is BH cube by 12. Negative, we have the area which is half BH multiplied by the d square. Now, what is d? D is the distance between the centroid of this, right, to the AA prime axis. So, distance between these two parallel axis, okay, which is h over 3, that we already know. Okay. So, ultimately the answer is BHQ over 36. So, what we have learnt now, that the moment of inertia about the centroidal axis BB prime is BH cube by 36. So, can we do this now? So, how to target this problem? See, let us go step by step. So, what we have done from the earlier studies, so I am interested in finding out the moment of inertia of this half circle about the x axis. Now, I have to make use of some known results. Okay. What are the known results I have in the hand? First of all, if I just choose the base of the half circle, right, I know what is the centroid location, that is r bar. That was already been done. So, that r bar is 4 r over 3 pi. Okay. Second thing I know is that what is my Ix prime? Ix prime, since it is a half circle, Ix prime should be just half of the moment of inertia of a circle with respect to its diameter. So, therefore, I already know that it is going to be, now this is for the circle. Remember, pi r to the power 4 by 4 is the moment of inertia about its own diameter of a circle. So, for the half circle, it is just going to be divided by 2, nothing is changed. Okay. So, I know this, I know that. Now, I have to utilize the parallel axis theorem very, very carefully with whatever information I have in the hand. So, what I will do suddenly, I will now try to go from this axis to that axis, because I is known in this axis. For me, I x prime is known, right? From I x prime, I will try to go to I x 0, which is the centroidal axis. So, that can be easily done. So, what I have here, I x 0, that is I bar. So, bar will always refer to centroid. So, centroid here, that moment of inertia about centroid should be equals to I x prime negative a times d square. So, a times r bar square, okay, because now I am changing from here to here. Okay. So, I will get this I x 0 first. Now, my job is simple. When I have the I x 0, I know this total distance. So, what is I x? I x will be I x equals to I x 0 plus area of this multiplied by the distance between this, right. So, from the centroid to the distance of the x axis. Now, therefore, what I have I x, as you can see here, is simply I x 0, that is my I bar, plus area, right, multiplied by the distance. The total distance is 15 plus r bar. So, I get this. Okay. Now, what we will do quickly, since we know now for the small shapes, okay, now you tell me which one I do not know here. All of these things are actually done in bits and pieces. I know the moment of inertia of all of these shapes or planar areas rather, okay, about the x axis and y axis. So, all are done. Okay. So, once I know the moment of inertia of all these sections or small areas, now we can go to the composite areas. So, how do I solve problem involving arbitrary shape or composite areas? So, therefore, depending on the type of shape given, I simply have to discretize that area into the known shapes. Okay. So, that will be the main concepts. So let us look at this. Okay. So I am interested in finding out what is the moment of inertia of this composite area with respect to the x axis. Now, why it is composite area? Because you can see that I can easily solve this problem. First, I take the moment of inertia of this rectangle about its base, right? And then subtract the moment of inertia accordingly of this. But it is going to be challenging. It's not that simple at all, because remember, parallel axis theorem we have to adopt in these cases, and parallel axis theorem only allows from that allows from changing the axis from the centroidal axis to some other axis. As long as I know the distance from the centroidal axis to the other axis, then I should be able to get the moment of inertia about that axis. So how do I go about solving this problem now? So first, compute the moments of inertia of the bounding rectangle and half circle with respect to the x axis. See what it is telling. We divide this in rectangle, as well as, let's say, there is already of this shape what is the moment of inertia, okay, about the x axis. Then what we can do, the moment of inertia of the shaded area can be obtained by subtracting the moment of inertia of the half circle from the moment of inertia of the rectangle. Okay. So let's look at the process here. So for the rectangle part, it's very simple. For the rectangle, if we look at this, that is simply BHQ/3. So B is 240, H is 120, that divide by 3. So I will get the moment of inertia with respect to the x axis for the rectangle. Now let us try to look at what happens to the half circle, right? What is the moment of inertia about the x axis? So for the half circle, now remember, what is known to me is moment of inertia with respect to AA prime. So moment of inertia with respect to this one is known. If you go back to the previous shapes that we have already studied, you can clearly see the moment of inertia is pi r^4⁸ of this shape. Moment of inertia about the base, that is x axis, is pi r^4⁸. So we are going to take this help, which is done here. So ultimately, I know the moment of inertia about this. Now what I have to do, I have to get the moment of inertia about the centroidal axis of this area. So again, I apply the parallel axis theorem, which will state immediately that Ix prime, because this is a centroidal area, should be Iaa prime negative Aa square. Remember, in other words, Iaa prime should be equals to Ix prime plus area of this multiplied by a square. So we are just taking it other way around, because I know AA prime, I want to solve for the centroidal moment of inertia about the this axis, centroidal axis. So now we are going to do this, right? Now IAA prime is already known, which is pi r^4/8. Negative A area is also known. We have already done in our previous study when we are talking about the area and centroid calculations. So that can be done. Then this is my moment of inertia of this with respect to x prime. Okay. Now what is my objective? My objective is simply to subtract this moment of inertia from the rectangle. Okay. Now we have to go one more step ahead, because I know about the x prime axis. So what is the moment of inertia about the x axis? Let's find that. So Ix is simply equals to Ix prime, which is about the centroidal axis, right, plus A, the area, multiplied by B square. Okay. So once we do that, we get this one. Now what happened in the process, I know two different result. One is that of a rectangular area with respect to the x axis, one is that of a half circle with respect to the x axis. Now our original shape has simply a cut out of the half circle. So therefore, I need to simply subtract the moment of inertia of that cut out which was found already with respect to the x axis from the rectangular area with respect to the x axis, right. So I am simply going to take Ix minus this Ix, and that will be my net Ix of the shaded area, ok. So therefore, what we have now, this is kind of the ultimate, you know, picture that we are looking at. We have found the this area has been found, rectangular area about the x axis. We have also found the moment of inertia of this shape with respect to the x axis. I just have to subtract this one from this. So I am going to get this result. Is that clear now? Can I have any question on this, let us say, moment of inertia of planar area?
How to find a irregular body moment of inertia with some arbitrary axis?
See, we are not discussing for about the arbitrary axis, because it will take, you know, additional steps forward, because in EMAC course, you know, we do not get into this principal axis and all that, that will be required, ok. So we basically try to transform from parallel axis to the other parallel axis as much as we can. And if you look at it, now where are the real applications of this will be some bending problem of beam in statics, let us say. Or maybe deflection problem in the, you know, in some kind of columns or beams, right. So when we are trying to study those kind of problems, just look at the problem. We always try to look at the, you know, bending of beam about two perpendicular axis. So there we are getting only about two perpendicular axis which are parallel to their own edges, right. We really do not take this thing forward towards, you know, arbitrary axis, unless otherwise your loading pattern is very complicated such that bending may happen about that arbitrary axis. But if required, we solve this, we again do this in the strength of materials, ok.
While dealing with the equivalent force systems, you stated a system of forces is been reduced to a single resultant force and equivalent couple. Is it couple or moment?
See, it is always the reason we said couple, you remember, see it is the same thing, ok, because if you think of it, it is a couple moment, rather it is called, you know, couple moment. It is in some text they will call couple, some text it will be called moment. See, ultimately moment is a very general term, you can use it. But why we are saying couple, can you give me the video please? I will just explain why do we say it a couple. So your question is why we are saying it a couple. Think of, just look at this pen, right, ok. Now how we are transmitting this force, let us say I have a force here, right. How I am translating this force to here? I am translating this force by taking this force here as well as another force which is acting from this. See why the couple is coming. Now this force and that force, they are creating a couple. So that is why we have introduced the concept of couple, ok. So it is a moment, it is a couple moment. It is a moment about the axis that we see, which is perpendicular to the plane, but it is a couple moment. So there is no harm to use either moment or couple moment or simply a couple. It is a equivalent force couple system. The reason being, just because the transfer mechanism that we are adopting in order to get the effect of the force onto the other point. Clear? Is that clear? Ok.
I have another fundamental clarification, sir. What is the difference between couple and torque?
Again, very, so your question is what is the difference between a couple and torque? See, couple, again you explain in terms of this. What is a torque first? Let us understand. When we say it is a torque, the torque will be something, see it is basically applied in the problem involving torsion of a shaft. So if you think again of this pen, right, when I will say it's a torque, when it will try to rotate this pen about its own axis. Is that clear? It is better to use this word torque. Okay. Now, if I have a force on this system that is really tries to rotate the, you know, this pen about this axis, which is this axis, then I can't say that's a torque. Okay. Now, couple is always the force, okay, that is the equal and opposite force. When it is on the body, then we say it's a couple. That means I have one force applied here, I have other force applied here, I will say it's a couple. Action of that couple will produce a couple moment, okay. But torque is completely different issue. Or torque is something that is rotating about its own axis. Now, I can induce the torque, let's say I can induce the torque if I go like this. I have this pen and I have, you know, another, let's say, you know, kind of bar that is like this, and I will apply one load here, other load here. Is that clear? So, in this bar that I have, I will apply one load here, another load here, that will simply try to twist the entire body about its own axis. Then I will call that a torque. Remember, moment is the most general concept, but torque is a specified nature of moment which we only study when we are talking about torsion problem. It is a moment about its own axis, okay? It's a moment. Okay, let's move on to any other question.
In generally, what is meant by an inertia?
I said when I started, see, inertia is the resistance. Okay, resistance to motion, it is as simple as that. Why it is resistance? See, it will be more clear when we talk about dynamics. You know, when I will be talking about dynamics, it will be much more clear. But think like this. Again, I can explain in a very simple way. See, let's say this is the axis. You think in dynamic form, okay? And I have a mass here which is trying to rotate about this axis, okay? Then what will happen? It will try to, you know, if I give it a couple which is trying to rotate the mass about its own axis, about this axis, then there will be a resistance to that motion. The resistance, why it is giving the resistance? Because different mass will induce different types of resistance, depending on the fact that how big is the mass and what is the distance from this axis of rotation, right? That will determine how fast I can move the body, how slow I can move the body, isn't that? So, in other words, depending on the R and the mass that we have, basically you are now talking about R square dm because you have now angular acceleration into the system. So, that will try to give an inertia force back onto this axis. Is that clear? So, in a dynamic way, you can think of in terms even particle. If a particle is trying to move, you have an inertia frame and you have a non-inertia frame. Inertia frame would be something that I am sitting here, this particle is trying to move. In the inertia frame, it will always see some resistance. But if I am as a person going to this particle and moving with the particle, then I will make it a non-inertial frame by saying there is an inertia force onto the system. It is a resistance, okay. So, this study, you know, it will be more clear if it is in the dynamics, if it is taught in the dynamics. But inertia is just a resistance to the motion. You can think of a bending problem. If I have a bending, think of I am trying to apply this, you know, moment equal and opposite, the beam will try to deflect, beam will try to bend, right. Therefore, immediately in the formulas, you will start experiencing that I am getting this I term. Whenever I want to calculate deflection, whenever I want to calculate stress, I am going to get the I term. Why? Because I am trying to get a resistance of this deflection that is given by the moment. Is that clear? So, inertia is nothing but the resistance to the motion. In dynamics, yes, it's a complete motion of the rigid body. In statics, remember, since we have considered the rigid body, it is not actually deflecting, so we need to look at strength of material to understand what is happening, okay?